A very good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies today. Our first item of business this morning is the consideration of two affirmative statutory instruments, the Social Security Updating Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2024, and the Social Security Updating Scotland Order 2024. These instruments are laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve them before they come into force. I welcome to the meeting Shirley-Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, and I also welcome her officials from the Scottish Government. We've got Kyle Murray, Policy Advisor, Dominic Mellon, Economic Advisor, and Katie Joshi, Lawyer. So thank you very much for joining us today. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited in the upcoming agenda items to consider motions to approve these two instruments. And I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I welcome the opportunity to assist the Committee in its consideration of the Draft Social Security Uprating Order 2024 and the Draft Social Security Uprating Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2024. The Draft Social Security Uprating Order 2024 provides for the uprating of benefits administered in Scotland by the DWP. The Draft Social Security Uprating Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments Regulation 2024 provide for the uprating of devolved benefits administered by the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland. I am pleased to say that the lead instruments provide a 6.7% increase in the rates of all devolved benefits. This means that we are uprating all of those benefits where there is a statutory requirement for us to do so, and have additionally chosen to uprate those where there is no statutory requirement. We know the devastating consequences of a hard Brexit and the Tory cost of living crisis is having a very detrimental effect on people. And that's why the Scottish Government is investing a record £6.3 billion in social security in 2024-25, delivering £1.1 billion more than the received via the block grant adjustment from Westminster. We are doing all we can within the limited powers of devolution to protect people from the continued austerity driven by Westminster. And since 2022-23, we've continued to allocate around £3 billion a year to policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible during the ongoing cost of living crisis. In addition, this year, as part of our annual process to consider the impact of inflation, the Scottish Government published a fuller multi-criteria analysis of the uprating measures available. We considered that the annual rate of the Consumer Prices Index to September remains the most appropriate measure to use. Subject to parliamentary approval, these new rates will come into force in April 2024. And I'd like to thank the committee for its scrutiny of the uprating instruments and welcome any questions you may have.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We'll now move on to questions. And our questions will be directed to you, but you are, of course, welcome to invite any official to respond, should you wish to do so. So the first question, I'm going to invite Bob Doris. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Can I first of all welcome that we're in a place in this Parliament where there's an obligation, a statutory duty in government to operate certain core benefits, if you like, by inflation. I think that's a very powerful thing. But it's always reasonable to ask, and we had this debate during the passage of the Social Security legislation, why some benefits have been picked for statutory obligations to operate and others are discretionary. I welcome, of course, that those discretionary ones have always been operated by inflation with this order as well, but that may not always be the case. So just what's the rationale and what's the latest thinking of government in relation to that?
Hey, thank you. Well, as you say, Mr. Doris, this was debated during the Social Security Bill going through Parliament, and it was the view of the government at that time, and continues to be so, that it is important that there is sometimes a discretionary approach to uprating. That does allow ministers to have flexibility to consider all of the different ways that you can support people. As the committee is well aware, social security is but one way that the government can and indeed does support people during a cost of living crisis, or indeed at any other time. And I think it's also very important to look at the different benefits that we have too. There are some benefits that are of a higher value and perhaps have a greater proportion of a person's income involved. And then there are some payments that are there and intended to supplement income from other sources. So there is a difference in the types of benefits that Social Security Scotland and indeed the Scottish Government administer. And that's why we take a different approach. And as I say, we're also looking at it in the round to see whether there are indeed other ways out with social security that we can support people. And that's why we have that £3 billion that we have overall to support people during the cost of living crisis.
Can I just check, because I'm interested to know the financial realities of some of this. I think you said during your opening statement that what we spend in social welfare provisions in Scotland is £1.1 billion beyond what we get in comparable Barnett consequences from the UK government. I feel like that's the additional spend that we've invested in Scotland due to our priorities. The gap between what we get from Westminster and the additional money we spend, the more that grows, does that reduce the flexibility that the Scottish government has to do more?
Indeed, it reduces the flexibility of the Scottish Government to spend that money on not just anti-poverty measures, but indeed on others. So if you do look at that £1.1 billion, £614 million of that is on new benefits unique to Scotland. That, of course, includes the Scottish Child Payment, which costs £457 million in 2024-25. We've got £110 million for other social security benefits, such as the Welfare Fund, discretionary housing payments, and the spend above BGAs for social security are around £368 million, of which £300 million is for ADP. So I hope that gives the committee a sense of the decisions that are taken, both in terms of new benefits and in terms of the policy changes we've made to other benefits that have been devolved, that has led to that £1.1 billion additional expenditure over BGA.
OK, thank you.
OK, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCallan. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and everybody, thank you for coming. In explaining the decision to uprate benefits such as Best Start Foods and Best Start Grant this year, the Scottish Government told SCOS that this will strengthen our collective action on child poverty, which I understand. If these benefits can contribute to reducing child poverty, why have we not taken a statutory requirement to uprate them?
Well, as I mentioned to Mr Doris, this is part of the wider discussion that we have within government about how best we can support people. You will be well aware, Ms McCall, of the action the government's taken to increase the eligibility for Best Start, for Best Start Foods, for example, to improve eligibility for another, we estimate, 20,000. And that's very important measure that we've taken that doesn't sit within uprating, but does sit within the changes that we've attempted to look at to increase our support. So again, this comes down to the decisions that government inevitably has to make about how best to support people, and that can be around changes to eligibility, it can be around the uprating, or indeed, as I say, it can be aspects that don't sit within social security at all, but may sit in other parts of government that will support people.
OK, thank you. That's fine. Thank you.
OK, and I now invite Paul O'Kane. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Cabinet Secretary and officials. The Social Security Bill, currently before the Parliament, will introduce two new forms of assistance, childhood assistance and care experience assistance. Would it be your view that there should be a statutory requirement to uprate those in line with inflation as well?
So, as Mr. McCain rightly kind of hints at there, that uprating is not in there as a statute requirement at that point. It will be something which I will continue to keep under review as the bill develops. I think it would be fair to say that what's in the bill at the moment, both for the childhood assistance and care experience assistance, is at the early stages of formation. Committee will be well aware that there is other consultation going around, for example, on the care experience assistance. So as we continue to then still look at what that benefit looks like, how best to deliver that benefit, until that's done, I think it is unwise to make decisions around some of the other details of the bill until we have more concrete policy formations. But it is something which, of course, I will keep under review as the bill develops. And indeed, after the bill, if Parliament chooses to pass it into an Act, we will, of course, make sure that we do everything we need to do in secondary legislation, as it's sometimes more important and more reasonable to do that in secondary legislation rather than primary.
I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's openness to that process. I was chairing the cross-party group on care leavers last night in this very room, and one of the discussions actually was about the importance of uprating in terms of cost of living pressures and the challenge that it really does exist. So perhaps just a question, will the Cabinet Secretary agree to consult and discuss with people with lived experience the importance of that uprating as part of that ongoing work that we're all going to undertake in terms of scrutiny of the bill?
I think that is a very important point. I hope Mr. O'Kane would be reassured, given everything that we've done in the past on social security, that we always endeavour to work very closely with those with lived experience, and we'll continue to do that on those types of assistance. And indeed other parts of policies to do with care experience. It's a very important point that we need to listen to, and I'll be happy to give that reassurance. And if the cross-party group themselves want to be involved in that, I'm of course at their disposal.
Very grateful, Convener.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Katie Clarke in. Thank you.
I was going to ask about winter heating payments, which I understand are being increased in line with CPI. And I wondered if any work had been done on costings of what would be involved in increasing it in line with energy prices, which, you know, as the Cabinet Secretary is well aware, is a major challenge. Has there been any costings? What would the financial implications be of that?
Well, of course, we do look to do what we can within the powers that we have to support people, and that doesn't just include social security, as I've said. The purpose really for the annual uprating is to maintain the true value of a benefit payment as prices rise overall. Applying a consistent measure of inflation across all benefits is more manageable and reflects people's overall experiences. I do appreciate that energy and food inflation have been very high during the cost of living crisis, but it is very volatile, difficult to predict. I would also say that there is a responsibility once again for government in Scotland, of course, to look at what can be done, but also to be very cognisant of the fact that the powers over energy and what can be done around energy bills lies with the UK government. The importance, for example, of a social tariff, which the UK government remains opposed to progressing in any way, shape or form that will benefit people. So social security and the payments that are made and will be made through the agency is important, but it's not the only way. And I think one of the challenges we have is an understandable but challenging ask for the Scottish Government to in effect mitigate for the inaction of the Westminster Government on energy and indeed on the ending of the cost of living payments. As I've had a discussion with Mr Doris earlier on, we're already £1.1 billion over what we receive in block grant adjustments, and that has to come out of the overall Scottish Government budget. So yes, of course, we do look to see what can be done, but there is a responsibility at the foundation of all of this for the UK Government also to ensure that they live up to their responsibilities on that as well.
Can I come back? back. I mean, I'm very aware of the UK's responsibilities and its failings. We spent the whole of Tuesday afternoon discussing a hypothetical social security system in an independent Scotland. Now, surely this is something within your power. It may be that there isn't the money to do it, but I'm asking whether you've done any costings and whether you maybe could look at that, given these are the real costs to people. Is that something that any work's been done on, and is that something that could be shared?
Of course, the latest ONS data shows that food prices had a large downward trend effect on the overall CPI annual inflation rate from January 24, and there's also no official forecast available for energy and food inflation. So it is a challenging area to look at. But I would say, with the greatest respect to Ms Clark, that the whole point of the debate on Tuesday was to point out the fact that there will be no change at Westminster to assist with energy. There will be no change to assist people during the continuing cost of living crisis. And that was why it was important to ensure that there was a debate over the fact that there is an opportunity for change, but it can only come with independence.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite, Marie McNair. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. As case transfer for carer support payment is likely to be complete in 2025, does the Social Security Bill provide a timely opportunity to introduce the statutory requirement to uprate the carer support payment earnings threshold?
The member raises a really important point, because I do appreciate that this is something which carers have asked the government to look at. Of course, at present, there's no legal requirement for Scottish ministers to increase the earnings limits for benefits delivered under the 2018 Act or under UK-wide legislation. But I do know that that is something that carers believe is exceptionally important for us to look at. The committee will be aware overall that the most important aspect I think government has a responsibility for is the safe and secure transition of payments. So as we move through case transfer for carers, we are very keen to prevent a two-tier system where some people are on one earnings threshold due to some regulations and others that haven't had their case transferred yet would be on a different system. So that's not a place I think that we want to be in. However, following case transfer, the way that the UK government currently looks at earnings limits and so on might not be the most appropriate or robust way for earning measurements in Scotland, and that will require further analysis. So once we get to the point of case transfer completion, once that safe and secure transition has been completed, and we are, again, I would reiterate, on target for the completion of case transfer as we had planned, by the end of 2025, then that's the time where that does need to be looked at. Member will also be aware, obviously, as we went through the consultation on carers, that carers themselves took part in that consultation and discussed the different priorities in a discussion that government wished to have, a realistic discussion that we might not be able to do everything all at once due to financial and resource limitations. But what we are committed to doing is considering that approach on the increase of earnings thresholds for Scottish benefits once that case transfer is complete, using the discussions that have already had within the carers' consultation, and of course keeping that discussion going as we move to case transfer completion.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Convener, can I just say, I think it's very unfortunate that Katie Clark came in here and asked Jeremy Balfour's question. She was late to the meeting. She takes over another member's question, which had already been allocated, but I accept that's your prerogative. The question I was going to ask was about the Scottish Child Payment. There have been quite a lot of demands or requests for it to increase by more than inflation, and I take what you've said already, and obviously £6.3 billion is a huge amount of money and a huge increase for the whole social security budget. But did you did the Cabinet Secretary, did you take into account some of these requests for, you know, a higher increase for the Scottish Child Payment?
Well, I do take those requests very, very seriously, and the organisations that are challenging government to look to uprate further are absolutely right to do so. The point that we have raised, however, with them and indeed I have made in the chamber on a number of occasions is we've had to make really difficult choices as this budget has gone through. I won't rehearse again the figures that I've already mentioned to other members. What I would add, for example, is going beyond the uprating of a Scottish Child Payment for inflation and, for example, increasing that to £30 per week would cost an additional £57 million that would have to be found in that budget and be taken from elsewhere. Increasing the Scottish Child Payment to £40, as some campaigners have asked, would require an additional £228 million to be found in that budget. That is simply, as members are aware, not the spare budget that's sitting there unallocated within the budgetary process. I would also point out and remind committee, and Mr Meeson was there on Tuesday as we had this discussion, that members from across the chamber were, again, quite rightly challenging government to say that it's not just through social security that we should be assisting people. We need to look at employability, we need to look at a wage, and we need to look at how else we can support people. That's exactly why we look at the three drivers of poverty and Best Start, Bright Futures, why it's not just about social security. So in summary, yes, we do look at that. We've taken the decisions we have on the budget that we have available to us. But we, of course, look at the other ways that we can support people in addition to the uprating of the Scottish Child Payment.
Well, then, I mean, in another year, if we can't do anything this year, I mean, would the government be thinking of maybe, you know, going a bit further with the Scottish Child Payment? Or if you had extra money, would you prefer, would it be some other benefit that you would want to move on?
Well, the First Minister is very keen to continue to look at this, and he's said so in previous occasions. The real challenge that we have is that we are continuing to have to mitigate against some of the worst excesses of Westminster policies, then that, of course, does limit our ability to do so. So, for example, we're already got £127 million within the 23-24 budget, mitigating against some of the UK government's welfare reform. Quite frankly, I would class the Scottish Child Payment as mitigation as well, because if the UK government took forward an essentials guarantee, for example, and universal credit and other benefits were at a fit and proper rate to allow people to be able to live with some sort of dignity, then the government again in Scotland wouldn't be continually being asked to have to try and protect people from the poverty levels that they're in. So, of course, we will continue to look to see what can be done, but it is difficult when we are continuing to mitigate against Westminster welfare policies, and it's difficult to see how that will change given the restrictions on the Scottish Government budget. But we will continue to do everything that we can, and we will continue to look at that in each budgetary process.
So much. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, I believe Bob would like to come in.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's in relation to the Scottish Child Payment. Was hugely supportive of, but the Scottish Child Payment is effectively, my understanding, a top-up for families because of the insufficiency of universal credit levels in the UK. That's effectively what it is. That's how you access the Scottish Child Payment. What's the Cabinet Secretary's thoughts in the new Economic Foundation's report in October last year that said even with the UK uprating of universal credit for this year, because of the end of cost of living payments, if you're a lone parent in the UK with one child, you will be £350 worse off in April this year as you were April last year. Surely that's unacceptable. Surely that has to stop. Any current or future UK government must surely do what the Scottish Government's doing and upbraid these things properly and not give with one hand and take away with another. Because that's £450 million of Scottish taxpayers' money, quite rightly, I should point out, going to subsidise what is effectively a not-fit-for-purpose universal credit system in the UK. We don't need reviews of that system, Cabinet Secretary. We need fundamental principles driving our attitude to welfare, and I'm pleased to see the Scottish Shell Payment does that. Has the Cabinet Secretary made representations to the UK Government about the insufficiency of universal credit, and will they do so consistently, irrespective of which government's in power?
Well, the irony was not lost to me, and indeed I'm sure to others, that at the time when the Scottish Government was increasing the Scottish Child Payment, I think at that point it was to £20, it obviously is higher now, it was when the UK Government was taking away the £20 uplift to universal credit. So what the Scottish Government gave with one hand, the UK Government took away with another. The Member's quite right to point out to the real challenges that we have to try and protect people in terms of a top-up when universal credit is at the level that it's at. That's exactly why we've made the calls, continue to do so, around an essentials guarantee. To ensure that people can, and you know, the clue's in the name, to actually be able to afford the essentials in life. And unfortunately, to date, that has been rebuffed by the UK government.
Okay, that concludes our questions. But before I move on to agenda item two, I just want to pick up the point that John Mason made in terms of the allocation of questions. It was agreed in this committee that the pre-brief, which starts at 8:45, is when we allocate or choose whoever wants to ask questions to the relevant evidence and panel that's there on the day. Unfortunately, Katie did come in late today, and I assumed she was asking a supplementary on the back of Paul O'Kane's questions. So can I apologise to Jeremy that question had already been taken? So just to make that quite clear to everybody in the committee, thanks. So moving on now, agenda item two is the formal consideration of motion S6M12001. That the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Uprating Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland's Regulations 2024 draft be approved. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion. Thank you.
Formally moved, convener.
Thank you. And I now invite contributions from members. No? Okay. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up and respond to the debate.
No comment, convener.
Thank you. Thank you. The question is that motion S6M12001 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. Thank you. Moving on to agenda item three. And agenda item three is the formal consideration of motion S6M12002 that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Social Security Uprating Scotland Order 2024 draft be approved. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and to move the motion.
Formally moved, convener.
Thank you. I now invite contributions from members. Okay. I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to sum up and respond to any debate. There's nothing to comment on, sorry.
Yeah. Nothing to add, convener.
Okay, thank you. So the question is that the motion S6M12002 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. The committee will report on the outcome of the two instruments in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve drafts of the reports for publication. Do members agree?
Yes.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and thank your officials as well? Moving on to agenda item 4, our last item is consideration of a Scottish statutory instrument, the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and the purpose of the instrument is to update premiums and allowances used in the Council Tax Reduction Scheme when the level of council tax reduction a household should receive is calculated. Do members have any comments on the instrument? I'll invite Bob Doris to come in.
Oh, sorry, I was happy to defer to Mr Balfour. I think to see, my understanding is this is another example of the Scottish Government stepping in to providing support that otherwise wouldn't be available elsewhere in the UK. So support it.
Okay. Jeremy, would you like to come in? Okay. Again, I don't know if the Cabinet Secretary wants to comment on that, or we'll just take your comments on report. Okay, thank you. I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument?
Yes.
Thank you. So that concludes our business for today, and I formally close the meeting. Thank you very much.